We are now on the first spot, which is actually part of the fire boundary route. After the war, Rotterdam really gave all its energy to rebuild the city. That was priority number one, two, and three. And it took Rotterdam 60, 70 years before we realized it was important to preserve the memory of the fire boundary. And that is why the fire boundary route was developed then. And here is really an interesting spot, because you can see the new city here meeting the old city, which was saved during the bombardment. And that is what the whole fire route is about. It's a spot where old Rotterdam meets new Rotterdam. And there's one thing which makes this spot for me especially very interesting. And that is the buildings right here. When I was a kid, we already had post-war buildings here. A cinema, an hotel, an apartment building, and an old church. And it's already been replaced by this new structure, a new church and a new huge apartment building. The church has the shape of a diamond, and the white apartment building is called the crystal, because it has the facets of a real crystal. That's how the architect wanted to visualize it. And at the horizon right there, you see the modern Central Station. It's one of the most iconic buildings of Rotterdam, together with the Market Hall. And it's really a must-see in the city. Now I will show you how the fire boundary route looks on the map. I have the map with me. So here you can see the red line. It's indicating the route. It's a route of maybe 12 kilometers. And the whole territory inside the route is the city center, which was destroyed, and the whole territory outside the route is the part of Rotterdam that was saved. So we're now here, and we're gonna make three more stops. Let me show you first where we are now on the fire boundary route. I have the map with me. So we're here. Just as I promised you earlier, this is the East Square. And maybe you can see that 95% of our view is the view of the modern Rotterdam, the new city center. So it means everything in front of us has been destroyed during the bombardment of May the 14th. Only a very small section of this area is still showing us Rotterdam in the pre-war years. There is a very important reason to make a stop here, and that is behind my back. It's that monument. I told you before that Rotterdam was defended very bravely by the Rotterdam-based Marines. And that is, they prevented Nazi Germany to cross the river and to invade the northern part of the city. And that monument right there was built to honor their braveness, their courage. It's called the Marines Monument. It not only refers to what they did in the week of May the 10th here in Rotterdam in 1940, but it is referring to all the actions, military actions, in which they took part. And there has been a long history of the Rotterdam Marines in this city. Their base was founded here more than 300 years ago. And their base was actually on this spot. And we can see it here on these three pictures. In the middle, you see the picture of the base at the East Square around April 1940. And here we see how the base was hit and destroyed, almost destroyed, by the Nazi bombs on May 1940. The Marines, they had their shooting range in the north part of Rotterdam. And it was quite an event. twice a week they went to the shooting range to practice the shooting lessons, and then they would march from here, from their base, to the north. And every time a lot of Rotterdam people came to watch that spectacle. They were really part of the city culture, you could say. There was one important building though, which survived the bombardment, a building here on this square. It was this windmill, a very old historical windmill. It was a flour windmill and it was built around 1700. So imagine, it was 250 years old. It survived the bombardment. But unluckily, 10 years after the war, it caught fire and it was partly destroyed. There was a good plan to rebuild it, to do the restoration. But the city council rejected that idea. And it rejected it for a very typical Rotterdam reason. We don't like history. We try to erase all the traces of our history. And the city council decided we don't want the mill rebuilt because we love this area. It's so modern. That old windmill will spoil the site. So that was the end, unfortunately, of this windmill. It's a 17 meter tall mill and its foundation was extended over and over and over again because the buildings around the square became taller and taller and taller as Rotterdam became a more powerful and more important city. So in order to catch the wind, they had to make it taller. And that's what made this mill extra special, but not in the eyes of the city council around 1953. So they signed the death penalty for this beautiful mill. It's still a pity. Sometimes the names of the Rotterdam streets reveal a little bit about the past of the city. And this is really a very, very good example. Let's have a look at that nameplate of this street. When I translate it, it's called the Rotterdam Zoo Street. And it tells us that before the war, we had the Rotterdam Zoo here, right in the city center, very close to the central station. This zoo has been here from 1860 till 1940. And to be honest, a new zoo was already under construction in the north part of Rotterdam. But most of the animals were still here. They still had to be relocated. And that meant a disaster because the bombs hit the zoo and a lot of animals died. But also a lot of animals escaped. And there is one story which goes that there were lions spotted on the call signal in the city center near the city hall during the first days after the bombardment. I think it's an urban myth. It's an urban myth, as many urban myths are created in times of emotion, fear, and confusion.